Good evening and welcome to Opera Talk. I'm Kathryn Smith, the General Director of Madison Opera, and I'm so glad you're here. Tonight's topic is song and dance, and we'll take a broad look at the history of dance in opera. And by that, I don't mean styles of choreography, but rather what kind of operas had dance in them and how the two forms melded or didn't over time. I'll move somewhat historically, and then we'll also take a look at some choreographers. For everyone's sanity, I'm going to use the words dance and ballet somewhat interchangeably in this talk, and I'm not going to get bogged down with academic terms about historical styles of dance. Life is too short, and I am not a dance historian. When I'm done with my presentation, we'll go to your questions. If you are watching on December 1st, please type your questions into the YouTube conversation box. If you type them while I'm giving my presentation, I will see them when I get to the Q&A. If you're watching this after December 1st and want to ask me questions, please email them to info@madisonopera.org. Now I will ask the magic people to share my screen. So, where do we start? Dance and music have both been around since the dawn of humanity, basically. Opera came into being in the early 17th century, and dance was incorporated pretty much from the start. Operas by Jacopo Peri and Claudio Monteverdi had dance episodes, usually choruses that were meant to be danced to in a formal style. Opera as an art form starts in Italy. Ballet joins it in France, a place we will visit a lot in this talk. So the Paris Opera was founded by King Louis XIV in 1669. So a pause, names of arts groups changed often over the course of history, usually whenever the government changed. So what Louis really founded was the Academy of Opera, which went through a number of name changes and eventually became what we now call the Paris Opera, which encompasses the Paris Ballet. Likewise, the Imperial Russian Ballet eventually became what we now call the Mariinsky. For clarity, I'm using mostly the modern names in this talk. A few years after its founding, the Paris Opera was put under the leadership of composer Jean-Baptiste Lully. Lully had worked as a royal musician his entire life, writing both vocal and instrumental music, and in particular, ballets. He was also a dancer, and in his 20s, he danced in a ballet with the young King Louis XIV. The king appointed him to a number of royal positions, such as director of his personal violin orchestra. In the early 1660s, Lully began collaborating with the playwright Molière, creating an art form the two called comédie ballet, as well as writing incidental music for his plays. Once Lully took over the Paris Opera in 1672, he wrote about one opera a year. He actually had a monopoly on the art form. No one else was allowed to write operas in Paris. Ballet was integral throughout Lully's operas, particularly in chorus scenes. Here, played by our video dog, is a clip from the prologue to his 1676 opera Attis, performed by the Paris Opera Comique. Retained control of the Paris Opera until he died of what one could call a conducting injury. At that time, conductors kept the beat by hitting the floor with long conducting staffs, and during one performance, Lully missed and seriously injured his foot, and the resulting gangrene killed him. A couple generations later came Jean-Philippe Rameau. His first career was as a harpsichord composer. He started composing opera when he was in his late 40s. His first, Hippolyte and Aricie, was acclaimed as the most significant French opera since the death of Lully almost 50 years earlier. That was a problem for Lully devotees and resulted in a PR war for the next decade. Rameau wrote dozens of works within the opera/ballet genre, as well as a number of individual ballet scores. One scholar calls him the greatest ballet composer of all time. And now, a pet photo. For those new to my talks, I believe in randomly scattering in cute animal photos on the theory it makes everyone's life better. So while opera and ballet were developing together in France, opera was developing in a different way in Italy. The main form there was opera seria, a noble and serious style of opera that consisted almost entirely of very long arias and recitatives. It contrasted also with opera buffa, or comic opera. And as a rule, opera seria did not involve dance. One of the great composers of opera seria was George Friedrich Handel. Handel was a German composer who found success writing Italian operas, ultimately in England. He ran multiple opera companies in England, for which he wrote opera serias like Rinaldo, Giulio Cesare, and Rodolinda, all without dance. But when he started his third opera company at the Covent Garden Theater in 1734, it already had a ballet troupe in residence. So the operas he wrote for that theater, including Ariodante and Alcina, all featured ballets, starring dancer Marie Salle, who will reappear in this talk. A few decades after Handel came Christoph Willibald Gluck, who was interested in reforming opera seria. His first attempt was Orpheus and Eurydice, which premiered in Vienna in 1762. It had some dance in it from the beginning. When he revised it for the Paris Opera a decade later, he added even more ballet sequences. And it remains one of the operas most associated with dance today. Mozart took Gluck's operatic reforms and advanced them further, bringing opera into what we now consider the modern day. But his early operas worked within older expectations, and his first adult opera, Idomeneo, contained a ballet. The opera involves the king of Crete, a Trojan princess, and a sea monster, and scholars disagree on where within all of this the ballet was supposed to take place. That tells you how unimportant it was. In his major operas, Mozart wrote a couple of what I call plot dances, dances that are vital to the storytelling because something happens during them. In The Marriage of Figaro, this takes place after the weddings in the third act. So while everyone does some version of a formal dance, one character slips a note to another character, which is then seen by yet another character, and all of this will drive the plot of the next act. In Don Giovanni, the end of Act One takes place at a party thrown by the title character. While chamber orchestras play dance music, the characters all interact, dancing with each other and making plans. This is from the Metropolitan Opera with Samuel Raimi and Ferruccio Furlanetto.
Non falli poveretto, poveretto, solo compagno io sono, la zerlina, novellina, pur qua.
As the 18th century gave way to the 19th, different schools of opera developed, and with them different uses, if any, of dance. Italian opera developed into the school of bel canto, with composers like Rossini, Bellini, and Donizetti. Their works tend not to have ballets. Think of Lucia di Lammermoor, The Barber of Seville, or Norma. They might have what I call the sort of happy peasant kind of dancing, but not formal dance episodes. Over in France, ballet's importance increased. By the 1820s, any opera performed at the Paris Opera had to have a ballet. And not just characters who danced, a separate ballet danced by members of the ballet company. Whether this ballet was connected to the plot of the opera was irrelevant, and usually it was not. For clarity, I do mean the Paris Opera as in the main opera company of that city. There were several other opera companies in Paris, like the Opera Comique and the Théâtre Lyrique. Operas at those theaters might have some dance, but it was not so rigidly required. Rossini, composer of the non-dancing Barber of Seville and 29 other operas, wrote his final opera for the Paris Opera. This was William Tell, which was on one level about the 13th century Swiss patriot, and another, a love plot between one of Tell's followers and the sister of the bad guy. Since he was writing for the Paris Opera, Rossini included a dance scene, specifically a scene in the third act in which the bad guy orders there to be dancing, and so the plot stops while dancers come out and perform. Danish choreographer August Bournonville saw the premiere of William Tell when he was a young dancer studying in Paris. He staged it for the Royal Danish Opera in the 1870s, and his choreography still exists. So this, performed by Darcy Kistler and Niv Anderson, gives you an idea of what 19th century opera ballets looked like.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to use this as an excuse to share my favorite quote from Rossini: every kind of music is good except the boring kind. And also, we need another cute pet photo. By far the most successful composer at the Paris Opera in this time period was Giacomo Meyerbeer. He wrote 7 operas, and they all include major ballet scenes. Robert Le Diable is about a duke who the devil tries to prevent from marrying a princess. In Act 3, there is a ballet of nuns. And I don't mean a stately sister act. It's a ballet of the ghosts of nuns who sinned in life and now rise from their graves, throw off their habits, and have fun. The ballet was intended to show off the opera house's newly installed gas lighting. And on opening night, one of those lights fell while a piece of scenery almost hit the main dancer. Live theater, even then. In Les Huguenots, an opera about Catholics and Protestants, there is a ballet at the start of the 5th act to celebrate a royal wedding. After the ballet, news is brought of the slaughter of the Protestants in the St. Bartholomew's Day massacre, and the opera ends with pretty much everyone being murdered. In Le Prophète, another opera about a religious conflict, there is a skater's ballet in Act 3. Women cross a frozen lake to deliver food to a military camp, then dance with the soldiers. In the premiere production, they cross the lake on roller skates. This is another opera that ends with pretty much everyone being murdered, except presumably the dancers who likely went home after the ballet scene. The Paris Opera's rules grew stiffer. By the mid-19th century, the ballet had to be in the second act, if not later. The main reason for this was the members of the Jockey Club, an all-men's club that had several boxes at the opera. Its members were interested in opera only for the dancers and not bluntly for their artistic skills. Since the club members generally didn't finish eating dinner until after the first act of the opera, they wanted the ballets in the second act or later. The height of this insanity came with Richard Wagner. The German Wagner had achieved fame with The Flying Dutchman, Tannhäuser, and Lohengrin. In 1861, he brought Tannhäuser, which had premiered 16 years earlier, to the Paris Opera to be sung in French. This is pre-supertitles, of course, and operas tended to be sung in the language of the country in which they were performed. Wagner knew he had to write a ballet for Paris, so he composed one for Venusberg, which is the first scene of a 4.5-hour opera and is basically the followers of Venus relaxing and having fun. The Jockey Club members were furious at having to be in their boxes from the beginning of the opera and interrupted the performance with catcalls and whistles. It was not all their fault, though. There were also political problems that would take too long to explain now. After the third performance, Wagner withdrew the score. It was decades before another Wagner opera was performed at the Paris Opera. Giuseppe Verdi adapted rather better to the Paris requirements. The Italian composer wrote 28 operas, and dance is variable in them. There is plot dancing in a masked ball, since its final scene takes place at a masked ball, during which the baritone shoots the tenor. Verdi wrote 2 operas specifically for the Paris Opera, which means they had ballet music from the start. The Sicilian Vespers has a tarantella in the second act and a ballet in the 3rd act. Don Carlos has a ballet in the 3rd act prior to a secret garden meeting. And in both of these cases, if you were to read detailed plot summaries of these operas, you could not figure out where the ballet would take place. They are that irrelevant to the story. Like Wagner, Verdi had to add ballets to a number of his earlier operas when they premiered at the Paris Opera. For example, Il Trovatore now had a ballet in Act 3 after the soldiers' chorus, and Otello had a ballet in Act 3 as part of the welcome for the Venetian ambassadors. Verdi's greatest dance opera is Aida, which had ballet music from the start, even though it premiered in Cairo. There are significant dances in 3 scenes, and one scholar said that Verdi could have been the Tchaikovsky of Italian ballet. Austrian and German composers put in the occasional dance, usually some kind of folk dance, as in Carl Maria von Weber's Der Freischütz, about a tenor who gets involved with the supernatural. 15 years after Weber died, Hector Berlioz reworked his opera for the Paris Opera, which meant he added a ballet using another von Weber composition. Friedrich von Plato took a ballet he'd written for the Paris Opera called Harriet and turned it into an opera called Martha. He left in one dance at the fairgrounds. And random fact, Martha was performed at the second inauguration of Abraham Lincoln in 1865. So let's talk about who was doing all of this dancing. Plot dancing could be done by singers. Everyone of that time period would have been able to do the social dances that were required. But formal dancing for showy purposes had to be done by trained dancers. In Paris, that was the Paris Opera Ballet, which was a full part of the Paris Opera. Russian opera and ballet were similarly coupled, as at the Imperial Russian Opera, which we now call the Mariinsky. So Russian opera developed along similar lines to the Paris Opera, with standalone ballets in some operas and plot dances in others. Let's look at a few. Ruslan and Ludmilla by Mikhail Glinka is a fairy tale about a princess kidnapped by an evil sorcerer and her fiancé who rescues her, complete with good and bad fairies, magic castles, and more. The fourth act takes place in the sorcerer's magic gardens, during which, and I quote, dances are performed. This is the Mariinsky. Prince Igor by Alexander Borodin was based on a 13th century Russian epic about a prince's campaign against invading Polovatsian tribes. Borodin worked on the opera on and off for almost 18 years and died with it incomplete. It was finished by Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov and Alexander Glazunov and premiered 3 years after his death. The opera's most famous number is the Polovatsian Dances, which takes place at the opening of the second act. It's a good example of the kind of opera scene in which the chorus sings from the sidelines while the dancers take center stage. This is again the Mariinsky. As an aside, Borodin's main career was as an organic chemist, doing both research and teaching. Composing was a sideline. Tchaikovsky's Eugene Onegin has two plot dances. One is a country dance that results in the tenor challenging the title character to a duel. A more formal ball takes place in the last act, when the title character encounters a young woman he had rejected 5 years earlier. Tchaikovsky is, of course, quite famous for his ballet scores, in particular The Nutcracker, which premiered in 1892. It didn't premiere on its own, though. It was on a double bill with a new opera by Tchaikovsky, Iolanta, about a blind princess who lives happily ever after. One subset of opera ballets was the Bacchanal, which was basically a musical orgy, drunken revel, and so on. A number of operas have such scenes. I've already mentioned examples with the Ballet of the Nuns in Robert Le Diable, and Venusberg in Tannhäuser. Another famous one comes in the last act of Charles Gounod's Faust. It is set on Walpurgisnacht, an orgy-like celebration of the night before May, and is Mephistopheles showing Faust the beautiful women of history. However, Gounod's opera premiered at the Théâtre Lyrique, a different Paris theater, so this ballet wasn't added until Faust was performed at the Paris Opera a decade later. It wasn't only the Italians and Germans who had to follow the rules. Camille Saint-Saëns' Samson and Delilah premiered outside of France, but has two ballets. The first one is danced by Delilah and the priestesses to seduce Samson. The second is a bacchanal, as the Philistines celebrate their victory over Samson. Another subset of opera ballet is what I'll call entertainment dance. It's not there for a plot purpose. It's not a formal ballet. It's just there because audiences are paying money to be entertained, and dancing is entertaining. For example, Carmen, of which composer Georges Bizet explicitly wrote to a friend, it will be entertaining. It premiered at the Opera Comique, not the Paris Opera, and so does not have a separate ballet. But Act Two opens with a chanson bohème that ends with a dance break. This is Agnes Balza. Operettas found opportunities for dancing frequently, usually by cast members. Jacques Offenbach's first big hit was Orpheus in the Underworld, in which the entire last act takes place in hell. You could argue that his version of the Bacchanal is the Infernal Gallop, i.e. the Can-Can. And it was a smash hit. One critic said, if you are not entranced by Orpheus, you have only yourself to blame and only your own taste to take it out on. Offenbach's other operettas also had dance, often in a form that to us looks like musical theater. Here, for example, is a number from La Vie Parisienne, in which the soprano sings about how Parisian women are good at walking stylishly. This is Marie de Valleraud. The second act of Johann Strauss II's Die Fledermaus takes place at Prince Orlovsky's ball, so there is general dancing by everyone involved, not to mention an entire number about champagne. I don't think they call them bacchanals and operettas, though. Franz Lehár's The Merry Widow is about a wealthy widow and her former lover, and has multiple scenes that take place at parties, so everyone dances. The operetta was a global sensation. By one estimate, it had more than 500,000 performances worldwide in its first 60 years. What became known as the Merry Widow Waltz is a plot number between the two leaves, as they can't resist dancing even though they are about to part. This is Felicity Lott and Thomas Allen. Back in Italy, opera was evolving yet again. The end of the 19th century saw the rise of Verismo. Verismo means realism and encompassed works like La Bohème, Tosca, and Pagliacci. Verismo works generally do not have dance. One could say that's because it's not realistic for people to start dancing in the street, but of course it's not realistic for people to sing all the time either. Instead, I think it's simply a continuation of the French versus Italian operatic styles. Verismo was Italian, and like opera seria and bel canto, did not dance. As we move into the 20th century, dance in opera starts to change. For one thing, singers themselves are expected to do more dancing. The most extreme example of this is, of course, Salome by Richard Strauss, in which the title soprano not only has to sing ferociously hard music for almost 2 hours, but also dance the 10-minute dance of the Seven Veils. And a little bit of trivia, Salome and the Merry Widow premiered only 21 days and 300 miles apart. They are a universe apart in every other way. Operas also started to incorporate dance in deeper ways. For example, Maurice Ravel's L'Enfant et le Sortilège, which premiered in Monte Carlo in 1925. With a libretto by Colette, it tells of a bratty child whose toys, storybooks, and animals come to life and enact some kind of revenge on him. Ravel said of the premiere, "Our work requires an extraordinary production. The roles are numerous, and the phantasmagoria is constant. Dancing is continually and intermittently intermingled with the action." The Monte Carlo Opera possesses a wonderful troupe of Russian dancers, marvelously directed by a prodigious ballet master, Monsieur Balanchine. We will come back to Monsieur Balanchine later in this talk. 8 years after L'Enfant, composer Kurt Weill wrote The Seven Deadly Sins, a ballet chanté intended from the beginning to meld opera and dance. The story tells of Anna I and Anna II, who might be sisters or might be two halves of the same person. Anna I is a singer, Anna II is a dancer. There is a male vocal quartet called The Family, and often additional dancers throughout. Over the course of the one-act opera, Anna travels to seven cities in the U.S., each representing a sin, as she tries to earn enough money to buy a family home. This is a clip from the Paris Opera with Anne-Sophie von Otter. So, Kurt Weill was a German Jew who had fled to Paris when the Nazis seized power in 1933. He was immediately commissioned to write The Seven Deadly Sins by a Paris ballet company that was backed by a wealthy Englishman who was married to dancer Tilly Losch. Neither the company nor the marriage lasted long. Weill's wife, singer Lottie Lenya, looked like Tilly Losch, and so the company required that Losch dance opposite Lenya in this new work. Bertolt Brecht, with whom Weill had written the Threepenny Opera, came to Paris to write the libretto, but it was not a good process, except possibly for Lottie Lenya and Tilly Losch, who had an affair during the rehearsals. The piece was not an initial success. Ballet audiences wanted it to be more like a ballet, opera audiences wanted it to be more like an opera, and all Paris audiences probably wished it had been sung in French instead of German. But it was quite a good piece, and later in the 20th century became irresistible to choreographers and singers alike. As the 20th century went on, operas from the 18th and 19th became more fixed in the canon, and opera choreography was largely confined to existing works. But some new operas continued to use dance. Benjamin Britten's Death in Venice, based on a Thomas Mann novella, tells of an aging novelist who becomes obsessed with a young man named Tazio. In the opera, Tazio and his family are all played by dancers. John Adams Nixon in China has a scene where the presidential party attends a performance of a ballet slash opera called The Red Detachment of Women, modeled on the ballets of the Cultural Revolution. This is from the Met's production, and note that the form is similar to Prince Igor, with the chorus singing while dancers dance.
Rise, embark its rise into the war, 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 war. Flesh prevails, the body grows bones, inflamed souls that mark its rise, that mark its rise into the war, 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 war. Arm the soldier, rise up in arms.
So, everything I've just said about operas that have dance in them have neglected someone instrumental, no pun intended, the choreographer. A composer writes an aria, and a talented singer can find dramatic meaning by acting the music and text. But a dancer cannot simply dance what's on the musical page. A choreographer has to set steps, particularly when multiple dancers are involved. So let's meet some of the choreographers who went along with the operas we've discussed. Pierre Beauchamp was a French choreographer and dancer. posthumously given credit for the codification of the five positions of the feet in ballet. Born into a family of dance masters, he started dancing at the court of Louis XIV at age 12 and gave the king dance lessons for over 20 years. Beauchamp was principal choreographer to Molière's acting troupe and then ballet master for what became the Paris Opera, meaning he was the choreographer for all of Jean-Baptiste Lully's operas. Marie Salet was a French choreographer and dancer who we met briefly earlier. She started performing as a child and debuted at the Paris Opera at age 20. She also danced at London's Covent Garden Theater. When Handel took over that theater, he wrote ballets for her in Alcina and Ariodante. She was also a choreographer and one of the first women to dance her own choreography. She choreographed and danced in Rameau's operas in Paris and commissioned ballet scores of her own from Gluck and Handel. One of her students was Jean-Georges Nevers, another French choreographer. He taught dance to the teenage Marie Antoinette, then worked in London for almost 20 years. While in London, he published a treatise on dance and theater. Among other things, he criticized the way that ballets within operas were separate from the story, arguing for the integration of music, costumes, and choreography. Marie Antoinette appointed him ballet master of the Paris Opera in 1776, a post he held for 3 years. A couple years into his time there, a 22-year-old Mozart visited Paris, hoping to get an opera commission. Instead, Nevers asked him to compose some ballet music, which became known as Les Petits Rien, the Little Nothings. Other composers were involved, and it's actually not known for sure which dances were written by Mozart, because Nevers put his own name on the score. Oh, and he forgot to pay Mozart, too. I'm going to skip lightly through the 19th century, as it's a little hard to track down the choreographers of most of those Paris opera ballets I mentioned earlier. We know that Italian choreographer Filippo Taglioni choreographed the Ballet of the Nuns in Meyerbeer's Robert le Diable. It starred his daughter, Marie Taglioni, and was such a sensation that he received a 3-year contract at the Paris Opera, and she was catapulted to fame, becoming one of the world's most celebrated dancers over the next 2 decades. Other ballet masters of the Paris Opera in the 19th century include Jean Corrali, Arthur Saint-Léon, and Louis Mérant. You have likely seen Mérant in a famous Degas painting of a Paris Opera ballet rehearsal. You already briefly met the great Danish choreographer Anthony Barneville, and you watched his William Tell pas de deux. Marios Petipa was one of the great choreographers of the century. The Frenchman spent most of his career at the Imperial Ballet in St. Petersburg. Logic would suggest he probably occasionally helped with a ballet, with an opera, but his great work was in creating ballets like The Nutcracker and La Bayadère. Let's move to some opera choreographers of the 20th century, by no means all of them. Rosina Galli was born in Italy and became a star dancer at La Scala in her teens. When she was 19, she became the prima ballerina of the Chicago Ballet. A couple years later, she joined the Metropolitan Opera in New York. She danced in almost 500 performances at the Met over the next 2 decades, largely in operas we've discussed, like Prince Igor, Le Prophète, and Faust. She became the Met's ballet mistress in 1919, when she was 27 years old, and over the next 16 years choreographed over 100 operas, including world premieres like Marymount and standard works like Carmen. And that brings us to a particular quirk of dance and opera in this time period. If an existing opera didn't have a ballet, the Met would often add one using different music by the composer. Such dances were called divertissements, specifically meaning a ballet that doesn't advance the plot. So Carmen now had a ballet in the last act using music from Bizet's Valsien suite. When Rossini's L'Italiana in Algerie was performed at the Met, Galli added a dance using music from Moses in Egypt, another Rossini opera. Galli retired from the Met in 1935 at the same time as the company's general manager, to whom she was married, and that is its own story. The Met's new general manager hired a new ballet master, who we also met briefly earlier, George Balanchine, who would become one of the most influential choreographers of all time. Balanchine was born in St. Petersburg. His father was an opera singer and composer. He studied at the Imperial Ballet School, which was renamed several times following the Russian Revolution. In 1924, at age 20, he defected to Paris while on tour with the Soviet state dancers. He was hired by the Ballet Russe Company and over the next few years choreographed a number of ballets and operas, including the premiere of L'Enfant et le Sortilège, as noted earlier. After the Ballet Russe folded, Balanchine founded a few companies. One of them was the Paris company that commissioned The Seven Deadly Sins, which Balanchine both choreographed and directed. Later the same year, Balanchine moved to the US, where he opened his School of American Ballet. He became ballet master at the Metropolitan Opera in 1935, when he was 31 years old. He brought with him his new dance company, which was called the American Ballet. Like Galli, he choreographed standard repertoire like Samson and Delilah, Tannhäuser, and Carmen. He also created new ballets, for example, The Bat, using music from Die Fledermaus, which filled out an evening that began with Lucia de Lammermoor. The Bat was a success, but 2 days later saw the premiere of Balanchine's production of Gluck's Orpheus and Eurydice. Balanchine put the singers in the orchestra pit while dancers enacted the drama on stage. The Met had actually done this before in an entirely danced production of Rimsky-Korsakov's Le Coq d'Or, starring Rosina Galli. But Balanchine's Orpheus was panned. The New York Times critic called it the most inept and unhappy spectacle I have ever seen. Balanchine and his company stayed at the Met for several years. They had success with their own ballet evenings and tolerated being part of the standard rep operas. But his contract was not renewed in 1938, and Balanchine publicly declared that the tradition of the ballet at the Metropolitan Opera is bad ballet. He moved to California with his troupe. It finally became the New York City Ballet in 1948. But he never left opera behind. 15 years after he'd been fired, the Met engaged him to direct the US premiere of Stravinsky's The Rake's Progress, which is interesting simply because there is no dance in that opera. He brought his Seven Deadly Sins choreography to City Ballet in 1958, starring Lottie Lenya, who had sung the premiere 25 years earlier. He choreographed a number of operas in the 1970s for the Met, Paris Opera, and Chicago Lyric Opera. Out of these traditional opera productions came some standalone ballets, Chaconne using Gluck's Orpheus and Walpurgisnacht using Gounod's Faust. Both of those ballets became completely removed from the plots of their respective operas. Here is an excerpt from Walpurgisnacht, danced by the New York City Ballet, featuring Kyron Nichols. I would argue that the only way you can tell that was originally a bacchanal is that the dancers are all dancing with their hair down. Balanchine's British equivalent was Frederick Ashton. He was chief choreographer for London's Royal Ballet from 1935 until 1963, and then the director of the company until he retired. And like Balanchine, he choreographed a range of works early on, including the world premiere of Virgil Thomson's opera Four Saints in Three Acts, which premiered in 1934 in the US. Balanchine had turned down the job. One of Ashton's first big ballet successes was Les Patineurs, The Skaters, in 1937. It used an arrangement of Meyerbeer's ballet from Le Prophète, but rather than taking place on a pond outside a military camp, it was an entertainment about a Victorian skating party. And unlike the opera, it didn't end with everyone dead. Ashton directed a number of operas over the years, including the world premiere of two Benjamin Britten operas, Albert Herring in 1947 and Death in Venice in 1973. He also directed and choreographed productions of Die Fledermaus, Manon, and of course, Gluck's Orpheus and Eurydice. Perhaps his greatest opera legacy is the legendary 1951 film of Offenbach's The Tales of Hoffmann. In the film, several roles that normally would be sung are danced, like Olympia and Dappertutto. Ashton himself played two small roles. Here he is with Moira Shearer dancing Olympia.
So, oh, then, so.
Choreographer Kenneth McMillan became artistic director of the Royal Ballet after Ashton and remained its principal choreographer until his death. In 1955, when he was 26 years old, he choreographed Tannhäuser's Venusberg Ballet for Covent Garden. The Daily Mail wrote, "The astonishing bacchanal dance sequence is the talk of the town. It shows scantily dressed bacchantes, sirens, naiads, and nymphs in poses that, in my opinion, would be banned from the Folies Bergères." The article added that the Covent Garden administrators will not let the scene be photographed. McMillan choreographed Gluck's Orpheus for Covent Garden in 1961 and choreographed the Seven Deadly Sins three times, for the Edinburgh Festival in 1961, for the Royal Ballet in 1973, now including tap dancing, and again for the Royal Ballet in 1984. And like Balanchine, he used opera's ballets to create his own works. His 1975 ballet, The Four Seasons, uses ballet music from Verdi's Sicilian Vespers, I Lombardi, and Don Carlos, all operas we don't associate with dance. Alvin Ailey Jr. was an American dancer and choreographer who founded the Alvin Ailey Dance Theater that bears his name. While a college student in San Francisco, he started a nightclub act called Al and Rita with Marguerite Johnson, who later changed her name to Maya Angelou. He joined his first professional dance company in 1953, then danced on Broadway for several years. He started his company in 1958. His monumental work, Revelations, premiered in 1960. In 1966, he was engaged to choreograph the new opera that was to open the new Metropolitan Opera House at Lincoln Center. Antony and Cleopatra was based on the Shakespeare play with music by Samuel Barber, had a cast of 400 singers and dancers, and set so complicated that soprano Leontine Price got locked inside a pyramid. It was not a success, but that had nothing to do with the choreography. In the 1970s, Ailey choreographed Leonard Bernstein's Mass, which inaugurated the Kennedy Center, and a production of Carmen at the Met. He also directed a production of Four Saints in Three Acts at the Little Met, a short-lived idea of having the Met perform at a 300-seat theater next door at Lincoln Center. The modern choreographer with the biggest operatic footprint is perhaps Mark Morris. Alongside his own company, he has worked in opera for over 30 years, directing and choreographing at the Metropolitan Opera, English National Opera, Covent Garden, and more. He choreographed the world premiere of Nixon in China in 1987. You saw his choreography in the video I shared. He has choreographed operas by Rameau, one of our earliest composers in this talk, and even the ballet from Mozart's Idomeneo, which is rarely performed. But he is perhaps most associated with Gluck's Orpheus in Eurydice, which he has directed and choreographed numerous times over the decades. Here is a clip from his current production at the Metropolitan Opera. Okay, sweeping conclusion time. You likely noticed that a lot of the opera ballets I mentioned are no longer performed. Meyerbeer's operas are rarely done, and if you happen to see a full-length Don Carlos, it's unlikely to have a ballet in it. And no one is putting an additional 15 minutes of dancing into the last act of Carmen. One could come up with a number of reasons for this. One is, of course, money. Paying, costuming, and rehearsing a ballet company adds to the budget. But the other is changing audience behavior and our own sense of leisure time. The days of people going to the opera on a Tuesday night for an 8:30 p.m. curtain and then happily watching a four-hour performance are long gone. Still, dance remains irresistible to opera, both in old forms and new ones. One of the great new operas is Terence Blanchard's Fire Shut Up in My Bones, which premiered in 2019. When it was performed at the Met, it included this step dance with choreography by Camille A. Brown. Okay, time for questions. If you're watching this on December 1st, please type your questions into the YouTube conversation box so I can see them. And if you're watching this afterwards, please feel free to email me at info@madisonopera.org. Okay. Hi, Lynn. What is your favorite operatic dance number? That's like an easy question, and you would think I would have an answer to it. I actually just really love dance in opera. It is not practical, but like when I saw Ruslan and Ludmilla when the Marinsky toured it to the Met, that sort of random 20-minute ballet scene in the garden, I was like, sure, why not? Let's have some dancing. Bacchanals, I think, tend to be less fun. I kind of like the dances where people are having dancing for celebratory reasons. So sorry, that's not, I mean, okay, I'll go Carmen, the Chanson Bohème. Always fun. Let's see. Is there a history of opera goers frowning at dancing by the principals because it may take focus off their vocal talent? That is a really, really awesome question, and I have absolutely no idea. Certainly in the 19th century, dancers and singers were both, especially women, were regarded as not respectable. So there would not be a difference between a singer dancing. It wouldn't, they're both already below the line of respectability. I think there are singers who don't like to dance. I mean, very famously, the first soprano to sing Salome did not do the dancing because she said she was a decent woman. I don't know history of an audience, but honestly, anything's possible, especially when you're talking about the Paris opera in the 19th century. Hi, Chris. When did the Paris opera stop requiring a ballet in their operas? I actually have no idea. I'm going to guess that as opera changed at the end of the 19th century and into the 20th, it became less of a strict rule. Certainly, the idea of the dancers as being there only for the jockey club members to check out, I think, went away around then. But the places I would say you are still most likely to see ballet, and certainly to see Meyerbeer, is still the Paris Opera, which still encompasses the Paris Opera Ballet. If you go to their website, the two are one and the two meld. Let's see. Do integral or shoehorned in ballets only get staged now in revivals of older works? What about Idomeneo, Tannhäuser? I have to process this question. I would say integral ballets, ballets that actually have a purpose, do get staged. Often they get cut, frankly, because again, we've got that 3-hour thing going on and people not wanting a long night. Irrelevant ballets are almost always cut. It's just, no, the audience doesn't want to sit through it. We don't want to pay for it. We, most of us don't have a dance company fully integrated with us. So when, again, I'd love to see a Meyerbeer opera and see what one of those ballets look like. I would think when one does it now, one would do it as a, let's show what it was, because it's such an interesting part of opera. Is there an opera that would benefit from the addition, I assume you mean, of a ballet, or which would you pick to add a dance to? Well, as Christine McIntyre, wonderful stage director, once said, no one ever complains the opera is too short. So I'm not thinking of any operas where you think, you know what, it could really use another 20 minutes of dance. What would I add dance to? I mean, all the comedies, but you know, Mozart doesn't need dance. I can't really having trouble thinking of an opera that I think that's what it needs. I mean, I saw a production of Barber of Seville that had not added music, but had a dance in it that I will describe offline. And I thought, that's really not what the Barber of Seville needed. And last one. You texted, you fixed it. Okay, so if there are no other questions, thank you all for being here, and I'll draw this talk to a close. I hope this made you smile for a little bit and that you have a wonderful evening. Go listen to an opera and maybe watch some ballet.